Easier. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much, guys. Warm welcome to all of you once again for this 10th talk that we are having as a part of the EdStop series. Today being the biggest in-house meeting that we're having in Zoom. We've just increased the capacity today thanks to the love that everybody across India and outside have ushered on this series and has kind of encouraged us to increase the capacity, which we have done from today. Before I introduce today's special speaker and moderator, I would want to take this opportunity to introduce our platform EdStop. The people who have actually brought this event to what it is today. I would want to introduce Devang Modi.
Hi, everyone.
And Ashit Parikh.
Hi.
So Ashit, me and Devang, we all three of us are photographers, and we formed EdStop in 2008 with the intention of getting industry stalwarts and eminent speakers to our platform and speak and interact to the upcoming photographers on different subjects, and it's been so good so far. This series has been a part of the lockdown series, as we call it, and we thought of this interactive platform to get people to speak to all of you, and in the end we have some scope for people asking questions. We've been really blessed that we've had the best of speakers so far, and the beauty of this platform has been most of them have supported us by coming online every single day and making the conversations even better and enriching. So thank you so much to all the speakers that have been a part of it, Paman sir, Fauzan, Swapan, Amit sir, Joseph has been there, Vishal, and all the other people, Raghu Rai Saab, and everybody who has contributed. Thank you so much, guys, for being a part of this. We can't just count our blessings for you being there for us. I'll just ask Devang to just play the video for EdStop, to tell us in a little about what we do. Thank you, Devang. There have been some messages that I'm reading that some people are not able to hear the audio. So Devang, could you just give them some tech help on that? Do they need to press some button or how does it
go? No, nothing. I think if somebody is having an audio issue, they might just want to log off and log on again, or there is an option of connecting to audio and they should all select connect to internet audio, since there is no dial-in available for India.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think everybody is now saying audio is perfect and they can hear. Yeah,
okay.
Ashit.
Okay. No, I was just, even when I logged it, I didn't get, usually I get an option of, connect with your audio. So today
okay, I think we are good. We are good to go.
Just to take the meeting ahead, I'd like to introduce Sudeep. Thank you so much, Sudeep, for coming to us. Nikhil will be formally introducing you. We've just seen your work and how it's been like a dream for us to have you on. I'd like to thank one person, Kanishka, and he's a part of the meeting. Thank you, Kanishka, for connecting me to Sudeep, and thank you, Sudeep, for agreeing to be a part of this elite panel, at just one phone call. I can't thank you enough. Thank you so much, Sudeep. I'll now introduce Nikhil Musale, my dear friend. Nikhil, if you're there. So Nikhil is going to help us moderate this event. Nikhil has been a very, very dear friend of mine, and he also needs no introduction. He's an award-winning director for Wrong Side Raju, the film that pretty much changed the industry here in Gujarat. And he just recently directed a film made in China. I'm sure most of us have watched that film. Thank you, Nikhil, for being a part of this panel to moderate it. I would also take this opportunity to personally request Baman Irani Saab. You've been there always for us and you've added so much to the meeting. Being a part of the industry today, especially if you could, you know, give your inputs and please add to the conversations as they flow to make them, you know, more enriching throughout the talk today.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much, Baman Saab, for being with us. Over to you, Nikhil, if you could just introduce Sudeep today.
So, thank you, Vinay, for a great introduction. And thank you, F-Stop, for this wonderful platform. In fact, when you called me up, I was personally very curious to know about Sudeep Da's work, his filmography, about his journey. So, just to brush through about his journey, I believe he is from Kolkata and he is a 2-time National Award winner for a Bengali film and for Bajirao. And I think so, starting his career from RGV to indie films and doing now magnificently big films, incredible career to talk about. And of course, two anticipated big films, Gangubai and Brahmastra, he's been a part of. So we're going to talk about his journey, about his inspiration, about many more insights, which I'm sure people out there are as much curious about how I am to know about him. So Sudeepda, tell us about your journey, how it began. What was that first thing that inspired you to become a cameraman, a DOP?
You know, I was a, I always wanted to paint. This is something I wanted to do. I wanted to paint. I wanted to, I think there was always that desire to express oneself through a visual medium. But wo painting technique nahi aati thi. So, for some reason, my father, I don't know what he saw or why he did that, but he gifted us a camera to me and my brother. And suddenly that camera seemed to be like the, I suddenly realized that I could make a picture of myself, an image that I wanted to make. So that was a big, I think, turning point in my life. Uske baad, yaar, bahut kharab student tha. So, like, you know, in people of our generation, the standard thing, procedure was that you join engineering college. I also did that. I studied engineering for a couple of months and then I gave it up. I just realized ki hoga nahi mere se. So I gave it up. I was very scared to come back home because, you know, people would be, obviously people would not be happy at home. Somehow I came and I spoke to my dad, and luckily I was able to convince him that, you know, this ye mujhe karna nahi hai. And he told me that, okay, what do you, kya acha lagta hai, matlab karo, ye agar acha nahi lagta hai, toh kya acha lagta hai? So I was not very sure that I wanted to take up photography or cinematography at that point of time. I knew I wanted to do something in the visual medium. So I thought probably I would want to join fine arts, or I'd heard of NID, so somewhere that was there. So so anyway, I came back to Cal and I started, I gave up engineering and I took an admission in a regular degree college. Okay. And around, this was also the time when my brother was also in a kind of a similar search, and he discovered FTII. And with my brother, I was, this still photography was something that we were doing together. So there was a lot of exchange that we were happening, and he discovered FTII and he decided to go and join FTII. So suddenly that opened up an avenue for me, because all this while, I was keenly interested in cinema. So with my interest in cinema and my liking for photography, FTI seemed to be the place to go. So that's
right.
That's how it happened.
Right. So as your first film was a Hindi film, Bada Din, And after that, you went on to do your first film with second film with RGD, that is Road.
Yeah.
So tell us about that journey. That how was the struggle of getting the first film as an independent DOP? Because that's always the most crucial part when out to start as a freelancer.
Yeah. So I was actually, after passing out of FTI, I went to Calcutta. Basically, what I realized in Bombay, there was no independent work. One had to assist, and I used to find assisting very boring.
Right.
I'd been a part of 1942, A Love Story. Immediately after passing out, I was an apprentice on that movie, and I was doing the making. So I got pretty close to Vinod Pradhan, and I saw how the assistant cameraman, how they used to work and all that. That never really excited me. I thought it was very boring to be running after and doing somebody else's stuff.
Right.
And I just started going around with my girlfriend before joining the FTI. And I wanted to go back and spend more time with her. So going back to Cal seemed to be the perfect thing to do.
So, right.
So I went back to Cal, and there was chota mota kaam, like small independent work. And I was there, but I always wanted to come to Bombay. That was the thing. So I mean, I was just so apna plan ye tha ki I'll go to Cal, spend a couple of months, and get married, and then come back to Bombay. But so I got married, and just about the time that I was planning to shift to Bombay, this independent film happened called Bada Din. It was a very small film. So so I thought I'll finish that film and then come to Bombay, which is what I did. So when I came to Bombay, I realized that I didn't know anybody really. So so I didn't know how to go about it. But luckily, I started getting some television work, and I did a lot of television work. The dailies nahi hote the. There used to be weekly serials, and there used to be a lot of star bestsellers and thriller at 10, all those kind of stuff. And a lot of the directors who are working today, we used to all struggle together in television, like Imtiaz, Anurag Basu, Anurag Kashyap, Tigmanshu Dhulia. We did a lot of stuff together. So somehow, I think. My friend Hemant Chaturvedi, was a very, very fine photographer and cinematographer. He was shooting Company with Ramu. And Ramu was planning to do Road, and he asked for some suggestion. And so Hemant suggested my name. So it was. So I got a call one day suddenly. I was at home, and my wife told me that some Ramu has called. So I picked up the phone, and he said that this is Ramu. So I said, who Ramu? He said, Ram Gopal Varma. I said, I seriously thought somebody was kidding, because it was so unbelievable for me at that point of time that someone like Ram Gopal Varma would call me.
Right.
But that was it. And it was just like that. I was very lucky to get a film like Road, because, ek first film se, to get a visual film, to get a film which demands a certain visual. So, Ramu, if you ask me, how would I shoot the film?
Right.
And I gave some, typical Bong intellectual stuff. I said, I wanted to shoot the film with Road as a character in the film. So he laughed a lot. He said, what does that mean? How do you do that? You know. So, but I think that's more to do with an instinct. I mean, one has to believe in that instinct and go with it.
Right. So you also mentioned that you haven't assisted much in your life. So after so many doing films, do you miss that? Maybe
I think I should have said, because when I did my first film, I realized that I was really lacking experience. So I had to completely learn it as I was doing the job. Assisting could have given me some experience, but
since you have independent, you miss going to other people's set. Maybe doing assisting, that is possible, and maybe now it's not possible to be on other
In a sense, I did miss out on the experience, but I think somehow what I've imbibed is completely my own. I don't have any influences. I have very little influence. The only thing that influences me is the script. I mean, I'm very open that way.
Right. So since there are a lot of photographers here, in fact, most of them, and there are many aspiring DOPs also, one of the key questions everybody asks me also, that is photography a first step towards cinematography? Do you think that?
I think so, yeah. I think Yeah, because cinematography is also a collection of still images. So from that point, and also, I mean, just being a photographer helps, you know, understand cinematography.
Right. And also, there is, also it's been said that is it important to be a good photographer to be a good DOP, or it could not be also? What do you think?
No, I don't know. Like, I don't think it's important to be a good photographer, because but you know, an idea of photography will definitely help. I mean,
right. So I mean, even that's what I've been also discussing that with Baman sir. When we were shooting, we always used to have the discussion about the link between photography and cinematography, because he himself has been a photographer, and there are a lot of DOPs who they think that they are not great photographers, but they have great DOPs and the way they shoot their films. So it's always a question, is there any link?
See, I don't know. I can't differentiate myself as a photographer or a cinematographer, because when I do photography, I mean, a lot of my photography is very cinematography oriented. I mean, a lot of the stuff that I do still photography for, you know, as a part of my cinematography process. Okay. So I find it very difficult to answer that. But with a little bit of knowledge that I have, it helps me a lot. And yeah.
So considering that the journey you had from in your independent photography to the films, is there any photographs which you would like to share with us, maybe that could give us more insight about the kind of work you have been doing about the BTS of the films, or could be anything?
I'll show you some stuff. It's very amateurish work. So, but anyways.
And maybe you can give me some commentary on those photographs. You know.
Okay. See, these are the photography that I do these days is, you know, some of it I do during my recces. Some of it, you know, when I go for an outdoor shoot and, you know, there's a off day, I would just go out with my camera and just and play with it. Sometimes when I'm in Bombay and I have no work, I'll just walk around and I'll do some stuff.
Right.
So I'll show you a small collection.
Great, we'd love to.
You guys can see?
Yeah.
Is the picture up?
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, so this is, I think, my last trip to London. This is Devon. This is Auschwitz in Poland. Also Auschwitz. This is Torun. This is where the International Cinematography Festival, Camera Image, is held every year. It's a fantastic experience to go here.
Sure.
That's Mr. Bansali.
Of course.
Moscow. That's my son and my daughter and my wife over there. We went for a holiday. This is Shantiniketan. That's my house in Kolkata.
Wow.
Yeah. I have a small story about this. You know, I feel that, you know, we used to have dogs in our Calcutta house when we were there, and we were very fond of those dogs. So now we don't stay there. And my mother and my uncle and aunts are there, but the dogs are not there. You know, if you look at that picture, the cats were always be scared to come inside our house because of the dogs. And I feel that it's the dog's souls which are there, which are protecting the house. And that's what the cat is scared to enter.
Right.
This is somewhere in Rishikesh, I think. Okay. I think that woman is very pampered.
Right.
I think she's sitting and while somebody else is doing all the work. This is Oxford Street in London.
Yeah.
I see. Khule aam chuma lene ka kya maza hai. This This is somewhere, I think this is Banaras.
Okay.
This is some Dharmashala in Rishikesh. I'm always very inspired by this kind of natural lighting that happens. And I tend to pick up a lot from this. These are kind of stuff that
I draw
a lot of inspiration from. Sorry?
So this is in between your casual trips or usually your Reikis or official trips for
this? This particular thing was during a Reiki.
Okay.
Oh, I love crowds. This is, I think, Penn Station, London.
Yeah.
Again, crowds. This is China. This is Beijing. So I was supposed to do a Chinese movie.
Okay.
Sometime next year, maybe. Mm. So this is for that. I had gone to Beijing.
Of course, not possible right now.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. This is Krakow in Poland.
Okay.
That's Calcutta fish market in the New Market.
Right.
Not very appetizing if you see this. This is Calcutta. See, I love the way this Saffron Brigade is charging towards Modi's poster.
Right.
Jaisalmer. I think there's also Devon in London, in England. Also somewhere in England.
Right.
This is the South Bank in England, in London. Again, under the bridge in the South Bank.
So one of the questions from the people is what cameras you usually use and which cameras?
I have a Nikon Z6 and a set of Nikon lenses, and I have a Leica Leica M240.
Okay.
This is from the St. Paul's Cathedral in London. You've got a fantastic view. Again, the London Eye. So shooting.
Huh? Yeah, please continue.
No, these are shooting. Beach mein time milta, to you know, I just go for a drive and.
Right.
This is somewhere in Germany. These are all pictures of Germany.
Right.
Neuschwanstein Castle. This is a Dachau concentration camp in, it's close to Munich. I mean, this is Munich.
Wow.
Sorry, that was, this is Reiki for Bajirao.
Bajirao. Which was this place?
This place. This is Abu Dhabi.
Okay, but you didn't end up shooting for.
We didn't end up shoot over there. No. This is a small village in France.
Okay. So the most common question is why most of the photos are black and white. What has been your towards shooting more in black and white?
You see, this one is color.
Okay.
I mean, this is my house in Kolkata.
Yeah. Is it still there?
Yeah. It's very much there. It's exactly the way it is right now. And like, this is the place I grew up in. This is, I think, Reiki for Padmavat.
Right.
Yeah. Mr. Bansali is showing that he wants to make a big film.
Right.
This is Ladakh. We did a lot of, plate photography for Bajirao and Padmavat in Ladakh. So right. This is during that shoot.
Well, I think this this background, what this was used as a plate in one of the backgrounds. And the
Yeah. A lot of it. Both in Bajirao and Padmavat, we used a lot of Ladakh plates. So I think Mehrandar Fort. This is somewhere near Chambal in Madhya Pradesh. Again, right. We were raking for Bajirao Mastani. And this is, we were supposed to do, we really like this place, and we were supposed to do the climax of Bajirao over here. Right. And then when me and Sanjay were like finalizing the shots and all that, our location coordinator, he just said that, are you guys like planning to go into the water and all? So we said, yeah, of course, the hero is going to go inside the water and all. So he said, yeah, but you know, just to let you know, this is also part of the crocodile project. So I said, like, crocodile project, mean the water has crocodile. So said, yeah, has crocodile. I said, no. Like, how can we? Then this got rejected. But otherwise, this is originally where we wanted to shoot the climax of Bajirao.
One of the lakes which were also used in Son Chidiya in one of the sequences.
This one?
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
In the sequence when the crocodile actually attacks the boat, you know, so since maybe then.
Okay. This is the Gwalior Fort. Istanbul, I think. This is again Istanbul. We shot Baby in Istanbul, so
yeah,
I had some free time somewhere in Bengal, some village. This is Calcutta. Oh, this is Oman.
Okay,
this is also Oman. That's my assistant, Oniban, actually posing for me. I shoot a lot of bicycles. You know, I used to have a bicycle. My first photography assignment, I had earned some money and I bought a bicycle. And that bicycle got stolen. So I have a huge soft corner for bicycles.
Yeah.
Again, Calcutta. That's Neeraj Pandey during the recce of Baby. That's Istanbul.
Oh.
And actually, we are on the top of Grand Bazaar.
Right.
It was raining. This is a village in Oman, and that's choreographer Bosco doing some stunts for me. That's my son, Cappadocia. Sorry. Yeah, this is again, I think, raking for Bajirao, Abu Dhabi. Ban Ganga. Somewhere in Thailand.
Wow.
Yeah, this lady actually realized I was shooting her. After buying the Leica, I realized that you can actually shoot waist level without looking at the through the eyepiece, and you can get more candid stuff. So I tried my stunt with this lady a couple of times, walking past her and all that. And I was not happy with the framing that I was getting. Yeah, I think she finally realized I was up to something. So, gave me a very nasty look. That's my mom.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah. Of course, Ranbir.
Is that? Sorry?
That's some ad shoot.
Okay.
I think this is Munich. This is a rickshaw. He reminds me of Anil Mehta. No, he does actually. He looks so much like Anil Mehta. And this is another rickshaw wala in Beijing.
Like the Dalai Lama.
This is Girgaon Chopatti. These guys, they are Sone ka karigar. So I had a nice chat with them. Bengali boys. That's also my son. Sanjay actually is not bad in posing.
Mm.
Yeah. And again, three films. So, another one there.
Yeah. That's my wife. I think that's it.
Okay.
Lovely.
Great work, sir. So, before I hop on to talk about your films, because that's a huge area, a huge space. What's your inspiration while you're shooting your films or while you're starting your films, you know, apart from the visual reference we all usually do, what has been your references as such in life? Maybe when you're prepping up for a film?
See, inspiration, to koi ek particular cheez se nahi aati hai. We get inspired by everything around us, about every, from, you know, every, stuff from everyday life, you know, the sights that we see, the books that we read, the music that we hear, these all kind of form you know, little images in your head, and they're there, and you start drawing from them unknowingly when you're at least that's what happens with me.
And you also mentioned me in one of our casual conversation that you love reading books, and that also helps you a lot.
I'm a very avid reader. I read a lot, and you know, the good thing about reading is I actually read more than I watch movies, because when I'm watching a movie, I'm seeing somebody's images. But when I'm reading a book, I'm forming my own images, and that's a great process for me. And when I'm reading a book, I'm imagining a place. I'm imagining what how the space is, and I'm imagining a face. I'm seeing what kind of how this person would look. So these all kind of form image banks. I think same thing with music. I listen to a lot of music, they all form these kind of hidden inspirations
maybe it strongly empowers the imagination also of what probably you would want to find.
Then when I'm reading a script, I start seeing a film, ek film dikhne lagta hai, and I more or less try to remember that when I'm shooting the film, of what was the images that had come to me. Of course, iske beech mein process hota hai, because it's not my movie. I'm not shooting a film for myself. So I'm obviously seeing it for somebody else as a cinematographer. So what I do is I share those images with my director in various ways, by showing him images that somewhat match to my whatever's come to my mind. And then we kind of come to a common ground where we know this is how it's supposed to look.
So one of the questions from that is, since you have done films from complete different palette of different kind of subjects, what is the major criteria of selecting or choosing a project or a film that comes to you? Apart from, of course, the subject and the director, but are there more criteria that goes into your mind? Because I'm sure that a lot of scripts have been approached to you now.
You know, this thing about choosing a film, this comes at a much later stage in your career. People like us who do only cinematography for a living, in the early part of your career, you don't have the choice. I mean, ek film khatam hota, you have to look for another film because that's how you survive. So sometimes you end up doing films that you don't want to do. Sometimes you don't. You end up doing films which you don't. You would have either ideally not chosen to do. It's only later in life when you can choose to do films really. And my criteria for choosing would be, I think if I when I read the script and I see the movie, and if it's a movie I have enjoyed watching, I would do that film. That's how I would do it.
I'd like to jump in here and ask a question.
Hi.
You mentioned something about the script earlier on, that I get a lot from the script. There are scriptwriters, and there are scriptwriters, and I'm an avid scriptwriter myself. And we had this discussion yesterday on my other platform on screenwriting. How much of the description between dialogues that gives you a sense of where the film should go visually, do you enjoy, or do you accept, or you feel there's too much of description, unnecessary, maybe like a novel, or maybe there's none of it? How much of description do you appreciate? I walked into a room, it was 10 by 10, it had peeling walls, and it had posters of, say, Govinda, Jackie Shroff, and somebody of that period. How much of that do you appreciate, and how much is that inspire you to come up with images?
I mean, the more the better, Mohan. The more information there is, the better. I still think that if you describe an image completely, the same description is read by 25 cinematographers, they'll still see it very differently. So I would see it my way.
But then too much of description, could it come in the way?
No. Because I feel I'm shooting this film for somebody else. So the more you tell me the direction in which I need to go, it's better for me.
Like what I just said to you, for example, of, you know, a 10 by 10 room, it kind of tells me about the character. Peeling walls, it tells me about the character, how the character chooses to live. The posters on the wall, it could tell me about the character, his likes and dislikes. It's got a lot to do with story and narrative. Apart from just,
yeah.
So sometimes what happens is that some writers get so into, you know, extraneous stuff. How much of it? So that was my question. So what you're saying is, the more the merrier is fine with you. That's good.
Yeah. It
it's not appreciated. Too much of description or too much of action lines are not appreciated, I believe, Pavan sir.
As long as it's developing story, as long as it's developing theme, and as long as it's telling me a little more about the character, rather than telling me about the character's past.
Right.
I can see it on the walls. So anyway, sorry.
There'll still be a lot for me to do when I'm shooting this movie because, how much we show and how we show that, that's where I'll come into play.
So again, one more question always arises is that we all reference and we all research a lot before shooting a film, or even for photographers, if they're trying to do a campaign, we do reference a lot. Most of us, in fact, it doesn't come out to 50% close to what we really reference. So where is the trick there? Where is your magic or comes in place where you try to achieve not you had research, but even probably much more than that. With us, we don't end up getting a 50% of what we have actually thought of. So any thoughts on that?
Yeah, see, I'll tell you what is my process. When I'm reading the script, and this is when I'm in my more final stages of preparation, I kind of try to fight every scene. Ye scene ko agar film se, and I actually have the discussion with the director that what if we throw out this scene from the movie? And to kya rahega? Usme se reveal hota hai ki why that scene is there in the film. Either it's giving an information or it's conveying an emotion or it's doing some purpose. So once you know what the purpose is, I try to remember that. And that's something that's the crux of the scene. That I go to shoot the scene with that very deeply, inside my mind. And then with your preparation that you've done, you have your own idea about how to shoot the scene. Then when you see the actor rehearse, and a lot of things evolve at that point of time because then everyone's playing together, and the director is there, and suddenly things change. So I find that process very exciting of collaborating with everybody, and finally something comes out. At the same time, I always remember what was the original reason why this. What is the reason the scene is there, and wo kahin pe chhoot na jaye.
Trying to find that
crap. No point has to come home. If this scene is doing that purpose, then that we should never lose.
Also, the question doesn't end there because your films are known to be stunning frames. From Guzarish to Padmavat, and absolute magical. And of course, that cannot be achieved. It doesn't come easily. It's again a collaborative work with your production designers, your art directors, your costume, yeah. Your director, story artists, and VFX. So how closely you work with them, what is the process with them and their equation? And of course, also from a lot of DOP lobby, we have heard that there is some magic in Sudhita's lighting, that is your forte. So if you can talk about the lighting part also.
Well, I'll talk to you about the prep process, and I'm talking about a very ideal situation. This ideal situation doesn't happen all the time. I would say more, a few directors like Sanjay Bhansali offers you that kind of an ideal situation. But let's just talk about that. So with Sanjay, what happens is, he has a very clear idea about how his film should look, but he doesn't initially want to share that with you. He's more keen to figure out what's on your mind. So he gives me the script and the process is, I start giving him references scene by scene. I create a look board for the film. Like, okay, scene one, these are the images that came to my mind. They could be paintings, they could be photographs, they could be clips of other films, they could be music, they could be pieces of literature, a whole lot of things. we start ideating on those. And he rejects some, he takes some. We have a lot of discussion on that. This is there. Like he said, so you would say that, okay, why have you put this picture over there? And I would say that maybe, you know, I like that little patch of light on the floor, or maybe I like that upholstery. And we kind of discuss it at length. And usme se kuch nikal ke aata hai, what direction we are going, what are we liking and all that. And with Sanjay also, we don't travel a lot. We just travel and we, you know, share some time, you know, just not talking, just like listening to music, just hanging out. And at the end of the day, maybe we'll have some discussion. So aisa karte karte, just spending time, you kind of understand what's on his mind. And he'll give little clues about, something. Yep. he'll mention. And then later, 3 months later on the shoot, he'll suddenly say that, you know, we went there and we listened to that music. And, you know, remember we saw that. So there's a lot of that. Then once the look is kind of, we know direction in which we are going, we start bringing in the production designer and the costume designer. And, everything is mapped to a very, very, with a lot of detail, and like scene by scene. Right. Before shoot, we know more or less how each wall is going to look, and against that wall, what are the artists going to wear on that. And like, so it's pretty pre-planned that way. At least from production design and costume point of view, there's a lot of like 4 to 5 months of prep, very right. detailed prep that has happened. Okay.
So in fact, before you actually go on for a shoot, the entire visual palette is there on the table. I mean, yeah. Try to get as much as you
yeah,
can.
Yeah, yeah. But also, we do improvise a lot on the shoot also. I mean, suddenly Sanjay would, the day before the shoot, he would say, you know, this scene, and we are like, we are late and we are ready and almost. And he's like, you know, suddenly we'll say, I think we should shoot the scene at night. Yeah. And so that kind of thing always happens. It's always fun, though. I mean, if you give me the time and the resources and the money, it's fine.
So since most the recent films we have shot, they have some huge on canvas, almost end up shooting some 200 plus days. And that is excluding the prep work and also the VFX work. So it's almost like a 250, 300 days of dedication to a film. Patience and perseverance is something which comes, is a major requirement or something. It comes into picture here. And then, so that's also very synonymous for photographers, patience to wait for that magical click.
Yes.
So how much do you think patience as emotion is important in our profession?
Oh, it's very, very important. It's very important. Ye to matlab 2 minute ka Maggie to hai nahi. If you want to create something that hopefully people will remember and hopefully will be to uske liye to patience chahiye hi.
So since we were talking about film lighting, coming back to your films, I think Guzarish is that kind of film. We do remember that when the first look and the teaser was out, it looked magical. But if you talk about that film, that film had pain and hope both as a very strong emotion, which
it's a very contradictory thing Guzarish had.
How could you blend that, both the emotions and
blend? See, there's no formula to it. I think you have to you have to just feel the script and go with the instincts. Right. If you're honest to that, honest to the script, then it's correct. What happens? I'll give an example. That a classical musician, you take him and you put him in a field early in the morning, very early in the morning. So who will sing? He'll sing Bhairavi. Because he's reacting to the to the nature around him and to everything around him. He's like responding correctly. So, apna, I think waisa kuch hota hai ki if you're being true to your to the script, if you're being true to your instincts, so wo sur correct lagta hai. Wo aisa tol mol ke wo measure karke to nahi hota hai.
Right. And what again Guzarish was again known about was some extraordinary frames and the lighting, any such reference, because that was probably your first film with Mr. Bhansali, I believe.
Yeah.
So, what was the reference point visually while shooting a film like Guzarish, because I believe the visually it added a lot in the narrative, again with the kind of story he wanted to say. So any such inspiration for a film like Guzarish you remember or you recall?
I wouldn't be able to tell you any. I don't remember.
Right. So, and now I'm coming from Guzarish to Bajirao Mastani. The first thing that comes to my mind, if I remember, recall that film, is the terrific war sequences. And again, I've known through a few of my assistants that if you actually see the location of all the war sequences that they're shot, it's as normal. Yeah. Now, is it okay now? Is it better?
Michael, I can't hear you. No, I can't hear you.
Completely got lost. Baman sir?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay.
Should I translate your question?
Please. Yeah, I can hear Baman.
Yeah, so he was asking about Bajirao Mastani and the spectacular war sequences. And for a lot of people, this is what he's saying, that when they went to the locations later on, they didn't look as spectacular. Is that what you're saying, Mikhail?
Yeah.
That's a lot of composite work.
I kind of preempted it and tried to translate it my way. But there it is.
Yeah, there's a lot of composite work what was your question? How did we do that?
Yeah, the war sequences.
So,
and also if you can show some videos about on Bajirao and how it was shot.
I can show you the trailer.
Okay, we can see the trailer also, yeah.
So, one sec. There's a...
Are you able to open it?
Yeah, I am.
Coming up.
We just don't forget to engage the computer audio. The two engage boxes.
In that dialogue box, the two check marks, you remember?
Yeah. Wait. So I have to... have to go on share screen, right?
Yes.
Okay. And play on from my side.
Yes.
Still give the goosebumps.
Okay, what happened?
Yeah. Audible now again? Sudipta?
Yeah.
Still yeah. Gives goosebumps. So, tell us about... Yes, sorry?
Itna din baad dekhte ho, toh usse galtiyan dikhti hain bas. It's just... all your mistakes, they kind of glare at you. Ab bhi chance milega, abhi itna achcha shoot karunga na. Ek aur baar chance de koi shoot karne. Bahut better karunga isse.
Expensive to do that, but...
I know.
So, terrific war sequences. But I know where actually it has been shot, and so tell us about the process of the blending.
The war sequence, yeah. So what we did was, I took the starting point was I took a very basic note from Sanjay, how he wants to have a thing, and he gave me a very basic shot breakdown of the thing. Then we worked with the storyboard artists, and my job was to narrate the shots to them, and the storyboard artists would kind of make presentations, make illustrations based on that. And looking at those illustrations, I would put in my bit where I would say, okay, here, no, this angle probably, look at it from a little lower, or give me a little wider view, or give me a little closer view. And aisa karke, we made a storyboard. Then again, regularly, to and fro with Sanjay, showing it to him, and he would give his inputs. Aisa karte karte, we would arrive at our final storyboard. So once the storyboard is done, we bring in the action team and the art team. all together and we narrate to them, okay, this is the sequence. Now tell us, how do we do this? And VFX, of course. So so this is a scene, for instance, of the portion where Ranveer is supposed to climb on the elephant. So how do we do it? So action would say, yeah, we can do, we can take up, you can't, of course, shoot the elephant and Ranveer together. So we know, okay, fine. So the elephant is one plate and Ranveer is one plate. And aisa karte karte, we come to a point that in how many layers do we need to shoot this scene? So then we finally realize that all we should do is just go to Rajasthan and shoot the background plates. And everything else is going to be a composite, like the foreground elements of the fire and stuff like that. And also, we're shooting it day for night. So
everything is shot day for night?
Yeah. We shot day for night.
Because I know Borivali grounds, you know, and if you look at those grounds.
No, this is not Borivali ground. This was shot in Raisar. This was shot in Raisar in Rajasthan. All the background plates are Raisar in Rajasthan. All the big horse riding shots, you know, those are all shot without the actors, they are shot in Rajasthan. Some of the explosions and all are all added later. We used to do explosion parts in studio, some in Borivali grounds. The elephant was shot in Kolhapur, I think. And Ranveer's thing was shot in the studio.
So what level of VFX does it really take, and how much are you really involved in the VFX supervision till the end? You know, how do you see the use of VFX as such in today's films? You know, you see it as a blessing, but at times
it's... Of course, it's a blessing. Of course, it's a blessing because, you know, the stuff like this you couldn't have done before. And it's fantastic when I actually use it. You have to be very involved in it because unless you're supervising it to the T, you will not get what you want. So VFX can only take it. Over dependence on VFX is very, there are certain things that you can do on post and there are certain things that you know, better to do it on shoot.
Right.
One should use it in the proper way, not in the way post mein dekh lenge wala wo ek attitude hai na ki.
Again, three films with Mr. Bansali, Padmavat, Guzarish and Bajirao. So how was the approach different of Padmavat from these two films, you know? Again, Padmavat has two very strong characters and very two different backgrounds of Khilji and Padmavat's character. So any different approach you had while shooting Padmavat from these two films?
No, when Sanjay told me about Padmavat, my first thought was, okay, back-to-back two period films, how to make it look different. And so once I read the script, that didn't really bother me. I realized that it's a completely different film and it's a different script, a completely different visual styling altogether. So that came very naturally. I didn't have to struggle about that. Bajirao Mastani was, the Marathas were very, they're simple people. They're not so grand. They're not so, we kept the storytelling very Amar Chitra Katha format, you know, very simple. Padmavat had a more conflicting visual style. I mean, they were two very different worlds. The world of Padmavati and the world of Alauddin Khilji. They were very different worlds. So, I mean, that way, the things were different. From more technical point of view, although the lighting tool is same. It's daylight is the same, but when you're lighting up nights, they are all flame sources. There are no electricity. They are all flame sources. But the flame sources were different. In Padmavat, it was all open lights. The fires were all open. There were no glass. But by the time we come to Bajirao's period, which is the 17th century, glass was already there. So the fire sources were contained within glass. So there would be less wind interaction. Hence, there would be less flicker. So that's something I did. If you see that. The light in Padmavat flickers a little more.
And in fact, that also is more dramatic also.
That's more dramatic, yeah.
In fact, one of the sequences in Bajirao, very interesting scene where Bajirao has been called in a new glass palace. And there is a scene in which there is image which is projected and which Kashibai can see So tell us about that scene and the research behind that, because who came up with that idea?
Let me show you that scene.
Very
good. Let me show you that scene.
श्रीमंत बाप शनिवार वाड़ा का सबसे खूबसूरत हिस्सा देख रहे हैं, आईना महल।
वाह चीमा जी, अद्भुत है।
आप तो सालों से दुश्मनों से युद्ध में व्यस्त थे और देखिए आपके छोटे भाई ने क्या बनाया।
चीमा जी, आपने तो पुणे में ही ताजमहल खड़ा कर दिया।
इसकी सही रौनक तो आज रात पाड़वा के उत्सव में देखना, जब जश्न होगा स्वर्ग लगेगा ये आईना महल।
सच, एकदम माया नगरी है। अब
माया नगरी का असली जादू तो आपके पैरों तले जो कमल है उसमें है।
मतलब
राव, इस वक्त अगर यही तो जादू है, जब आप इस कमल पर खड़े रहते हैं तो आपका प्रतिबिंब इस आईने में दिखाई देता है और यहाँ से सीधा काशी वहिनी के कमरे की छोटी खिड़की पर चमकता है।
काशी ताई, रोशनी खिड़की से आ रही है, आईना चमकता है।
खरच
खरच, चलो 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 चलो।
पानी में रखे हुए फिरंगी कांच से होते हुए उनके कमरे के पर्दे पर दिखाई देता है।
काशीताई, करो ना जल्दी जल्दी।
हो भाई, करते। भैया, आईना महल से सीधा यहाँ दिख रहे राव। खैर जादू ना भाई, हमारे राव भी तो देखो कितने सुंदर लग रहे हैं।
नजर मत लगा उनको।
वाह, हम उनकी बहनें उन्हें नजर लगाएंगी। वहाँ नवाब की बीवियाँ उनको एक नजर देखने को तरसती हैं।
तरसती? मोतियों से नजर उतारती है उनकी।
वो चाहे मोतियों से तो
या।
इसको बंद कैसे करोगे?
We can hear you.
We can see you. Yeah, it's gone.
We can see you and hear you now.
One second.
Ajay, it's playing at your end. So yeah, tell us about the trivia behind this scene.
So you know, when you go to this old palaces and old forts and all that, well, the guides tell you all these crazy stories that, you know, aisa aisa hota tha, and then the king used to stand over there and used to whisper, or itna dur udhar jaake the queen used to hear it, and all these kind of strange stories you hear, or little magical things. And I think Sanjay wanted to incorporate something like that. So, I mean, the idea was to use some of those, like, you know, those magical things that that happened, that used to happen. Now, originally the thought was to use a mirror, and through the mirror that reflection will come. And I felt that maybe we should use the idea of, you know, a projected image like a film, and wo film jaisa dikhega, you know, that's be quite magical and. So Sanjay really liked the idea. The concern was everyone and all the assistant directors and all my assistants, and everyone was like, you know, how will we justify this? Like a projected image and all, how do we justify it? So Sanjay's whole thing was that, you know, do it really well, make it so spectacular that people don't question it. And we went with this. I mean, I honestly was a little scared that some people might say, ki ye kya dikhaya, ye kya, aisa kaise hota hai? Aisa koi paani mein aaya, aur phir mirror se aaya. Like,
I am an electronics engineer, and I felt that maybe it must have happened there. So, Baman sir, this is where the reality versus cinema comes in. You know, you right. The make dramatically so believable right. That there is no question on it.
I think it's the director who sets up that.
You're selling a lie in any case.
Yeah.
Ranveer Singh is not that person. Deepika is not that person. You're selling a lie in any case. You're making him the people. Believe that they are that person. Acting is lying, you know. Recreation is a lie. Just how convincing is your lie is what is important, and how interesting.
But this is a confusion that that always we director of photography we always have, because, you know, although you're selling a lie, the world has to be believable, because, you know, if it's too unbelievable, absolutely. Then you start kind of questioning that, and start getting distracted. But wo realism ke chakkar mein bahut baar ki hum apna kaam ko bahut boring kar dete. Wo ek wo sometimes wo chhalang lena chahiye mujhe lagta hai.
Bilkul kar do, bilkul ma lazim hai isme kya hai. You know, yeah. I needed to ask a question. You the way you light things up is so spectacular. I think everybody's jaw was dropped. When it comes to direct lighting actors, do the actors, you know, in the good old days, Mr. Bachchan was telling me that when they were shooting Shole, the great Dwarka Divecha would never let a stand-in stand over there. Yeah. He would actually be pretty rough on them. He'd say, hey, Dharam, khade ho jaha pe. Hey, Amit, khade ho jaha pe. And he would make us stand in the heat and make sure that he would light up before, you know, he'd give them a break, but he'd light up that individual face by itself. How difficult it is to light up an actor, and how much time do you need, and are stand-ins a good way to go?
To an extent, a stand-in, you know, there's some very basic thing that I'm okay to do with a stand-in, but I mean, actor stepping in, and a good actor actually never has to be told. I work with some actors who don't need to be told. If you're doing their close-up, they would invariably come and stand in for their lighting, because it's completely different. And it's very important to watch the rehearsal.
It's coming to that. Yeah, tell us that. It's very important. Yeah.
Yeah, it's very important to watch the rehearsal. You know, sometimes with some actors, asking them to rehearse, they kind of exhaust themselves on the rehearsal. So, wo ek ye rehta hai ki, you know, just do it mechanically, but show me in which way you're looking, what are you, how you're playing it. It helps me a lot.
What are you looking out for in a rehearsal, Lars?
I'm looking out for the eyes.
Oh, wow.
Because that's the only thing that that gives me the truth. And that's the only thing that I'm interested in. And I personally, I like shooting close-ups the most. I mean, I find that that's the most interesting. A human face is the most exciting landscape for me. Mm, and yeah. There's so much happening there. And the whole joy of, you know, extracting that that piece of truth from an actor's eye. And I think that's what is my job. And a cinematographer has to do that. He has to provide an actor that space to perform. And you have to choose the right angle. You have to choose the right lighting. You have to light up your eyes.
And this is the nicest thing I've ever heard, you know. Yeah. Honestly, it is one of the nicest things I've ever heard. Tell me one thing. Now, there's a spectacle. And then there is a human drama. And there's human conflict, which I think is the basis of any story. Without a conflict, there is no story. There can be as much spectacle as you want. So when it is, you know, most of the time you hear that, you see the people are smacking their lips to light up a set, and everybody would be, you know, give an arm and a leg to be in your place to light up those spectacular sets. But you've been there, you've done that. And a lot of people feel it's very boring to light up two actors who are standing opposite each other having a conversation about life or having a conversation in conflict. How important are those scenes to you? Because a lot of cinematographers say, "Ye to kamal hai, uski chapati." They always use that term. Iski chapati, fir uski chapati. Ho gaya kaam. Ek milenge, ab hum log master lenge. Fir OS, kaam ho gaya. Tell me how. How you approach that?
When I look back at a scene, most of the times, all you remember is an actor's face. Baat udhar hi hai. So I give that a lot of importance. Because, as I told you, I mean, I find it the most exciting to shoot actors, because of course, I mean, landscape shots and, you know, scale shots, that's where you show your craft. But I think the soul is in an actor's face. That's where. Yeah. I think it's very challenging to do that also. Bahut maza aata hai.
In fact, one more another film from the recent ones is a film Chak De India, especially the sport, the way the hockey was really shot, and how it helped the narrative so much. So can you just tell us something about the hockey sequences in Chak De, and what was the approach there?
See, my approach was, I realized that, you know, we are used to watching a lot of sports on television.
Right.
And that will be the television, you watch sports on television. There will be a wide camera where you'll establish geography, and there'll be tele cameras following the action. But it's only a very external view. And I felt the only way to make it look different was, you know, you get right in the middle of the field, and you know, you move with the ball. And also to create a kind of a chaos, you know, from my memory of when in my youth, when I used to play football and hockey and cricket, you know, the experience of playing is it's a chaos. It's very chaotic. And I wanted to capture that chaos. I wanted to, hence it was handheld and it was dirty. And because I wanted to give the feel of the whole match from the player's perspective.
Real matches, you don't see the chaos because the chaos is in between the ground.
Yeah, yeah. So that was a ground rule that we had. And Shimit is a very, very wonderful photographer himself. And Shimit came up with some very, very interesting points and very helpful tips. And like his one of the things was that, you know, Shudeep, because we when we were raking and all that, it was very disheartening to see the actual state of the women's hockey hostel, you know, the national hostel and all that. And it's like it's like neglected and it's like... So one of the things that Shimita told me that, you know, Shudeep, we have to be very truthful to this.
So in fact, if talking about Dhoom 3, one of the insights is that it was one of the films which was shot on digital. And again, my question is, again, a lot of photographers are curious about it, that do you miss shooting on film cameras? And Dhoom 3 is a film which was shot on digital. And of course, you have been one of the game changer of convincing a lot of directors from shifting from film camera to digital. So if you can tell us something about that.
Yeah, Dhoom was probably the first big Bollywood commercial film to be shot on digital. And when I told everyone, my producer, Aditya Chopra, and my director, and they were all very surprised at why. I mean, like, he said, no, this is not a low-budget film. This is Dhoom 3. We have the money to shoot on film. But I'll tell you where I was coming from. Guzarish was processed by Deluxe, Color by Deluxe. You know, seeing these Hollywood films, Color by Deluxe. So Deluxe had come to India, and the only film they've done is Guzarish.
Right.
And they had processed Guzarish. And when the print came out, I can't tell you. I mean, I didn't believe it was my work. It was so beautiful. I've never seen a print like that. And while we were very happy. And you know, those days, the main thing was still the film print. Although we were finishing it digitally, but it was still the film print. So that's where our main focus used to go. And our attitude towards a DCP was like, "Ha, theek hai, wo to dekhenge, wo to theek hai, wo utna important nahi hai." So the print was out, and to my utter shock, I realized that at that point of time in 2011, when Guzarish was, you know, how many prints were required? There were 6 prints required. And it just completely broke my heart that, you know, 6 prints is all. One theater in Borivali, and one in Bhiwandi, and that's all. All the major theaters in Bombay were showing a DCP. And when I was doing the DCP, it was a huge struggle because, we'd scanned it for a film print. So one had to go for a rescan, one had to... It was a completely different process. And I realized that if this end result is this, then I have to put in more mind on that. So then the idea came to me that, you know, probably one should look at, so originating on digital. And I was continuously in touch with Ari. When the first round of Alexa had come out, we from Cinematographers Combined, we had done a test. And it was not, I had shot one of the tests, and Amit Roy had shot another other tests. And collectively, we still felt that the film image was superior to the Alexa image at that point of time. This was 2009. But by 2011-12, Alexa, they were coming up with more upgrades, and Ari was continuously in touch with us. And I had seen the latest update on Alexa, and I was very excited with it. So, but still, my producer was not very excited about shooting on digital. So what I did is I took a scene, I lit up a scene in a studio, and I shot it with a red camera. I shot it with a film camera, and I shot the same scene with an Alexa. And I projected it for my director and my producer, and I asked them, "You all choose whatever you all like. I'll go with that." So they all pointed at the Alexa footage, and they said, "Yeah, we like film." So that's how started. I'm sorry. I feel bad that it was because of me shooting Dhoom. Film probably made a quicker exit than we thought, and I feel bad about it. It was a wonderful thing. I still miss shooting a lot on film. But
as you think, also,
more in a romantic way. I mean, if you ask me logically, would you shoot a film? If you shoot, would you shoot your next film on film or digital? The romantic side in me would say film, because I like it, but logically,
a film also brought a lot of discipline.
Absolutely. I mean, I think what has gone is, I think the certain sanctity of the shot is gone. I mean, we have forgotten that a shot is a precious thing. That I hear sometimes the director tells you to roll the rehearsal, and just because it's free, and I feel we shouldn't do that. We should maintain the discipline of filmmaking. That, you know, because on a rehearsal, I'm operating as a director of photography. I'm looking at lighting. I'm looking at a lot of other things. But when you tell me that, okay, rehearsals are done, now it's a shot, I'm there now as a filmmaker, and I put all other faculties at rest, and I'm only living that moment. So that moment is very pious. When you roll the camera and when you say it's a shot, it's a very precious
action
moment.
And cut. Between action and cut.
Yeah.
Like, I know, even as an actor. But sometimes I prefer a little pre-roll personally. But that's another story. I want to ask you one question. It might not, I don't know how many people be interested with it, but it's a very pertinent question as far as I'm concerned. Camera movement, Shudeep, camera movement. Sometimes I see films that the camera moves in every single grip device has been used in the entire film, and you feel giddy after a certain time.
Yeah.
Especially in drama, you know, when is it appropriate? And this may be a good question for directors who are sitting in there, maybe even cinematographers. When is a good moment? And when do you decide between you and the director as to when and how much a camera will move in whichever direction?
You know, I feel it's very conversational for me. I approach a scene in a way that how close do I want to be to my actor? I mean, that's how I go with my lights, with my lensing. I mean, I can do the same lensing to get the same image size. I can use a wider lens and come close, or I can use a tighter lens and go back, and the same image. So how do I decide on where to put the camera? Is how close do I want to be with the actor? And so that's the way, that's my process. As far as movement is concerned, there are certain times when I'm talking to you, you were sitting on that sofa and I'm sitting on that sofa, and you're saying something important, and I feel like I should move to you. I should, like, so that guidance comes from the dialogue. If it's required, I personally prefer that only if it's required and it really calls for a movement one should. Otherwise, too much movement, I find it a little distracting. Sometimes a very little imperceptible moving in can be emphatic, and that's it. But, Godard has a very nice thing to say about camera movement. He said it's a moral statement. Every time you're doing that, you'll be responsible for it, because you're changing the background and it's bringing in a lot of change. So I completely agree with you. I mean, I'm all for, it can be very distracting.
Who decides? Sorry, one moment, sir. Who decides sometimes? Do you sometimes make a call and you just say, track lagao aur hum ye point pe rehearsal dekhne ke baad, ek do take dekhne ke baad, now slowly you instruct your colleague?
I mean, depends on your relationship with the director woman. With some directors that I work with, they just don't get into it at all. Some directors are more collaborative. Some directors are very much a part of the choreography. It can be certain directors I have worked with are very insecure not to move the camera. They feel that if they don't move the camera, they are not doing the job. Kuch to hona chahiye.
That's the problem.
Kuch to hona chahiye. To ek jhum karte to yahan se yahan aate, or like.
Right. Let's do Tanda with the camera. Let the camera do the acting and drama.
A lot of directors, they feel actually that if I'm not moving the camera, then what am I doing? I mean, log kya bol rahe hain, main static shot mein pura scene kiya. So main kya kiya?
It does feel that, because it gets over very easily, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
So, any of the videos you want to show? Because we have.
Apna Mikhil, there have been some questions that have come in. I don't know if you. So maybe you do a couple of questions before.
I will. Maybe one video we can see. Any of the videos which is.
Good. Go on. Great job. Going
well. You want to tell me which one or like?
You want to. There's still 3-4 media videos yet to be seen. Any of your film videos?
If there are any videos, you know, that you shared with us, you would want to share with the people which have interesting behind the scenes stories.
Yeah.
You know, and you could talk about the lighting, because I see a lot of questions coming in about how you light your scenes. So if there's something interesting that you could, you know, want to talk about
that particular scene.
Okay. Let's see.
Go for it, man.
Let me just stop this.
Yeah. So, Sudhita, this is again one of my favorite climax scenes.
Well, let me just stop it. It's not stopping on my end.
Okay. It's happening now?
It's just give me a second.
We can hear you very clearly, in fact.
It's playing on my computer, so I'm not being able to stop it.
Yeah.
It's not playing here though, so we can only hear you. So I think it's fine. It'll
let it play. As long as it doesn't interrupt you, we are okay with it because we can hear you.
We can hear you clearly.
I think in his headset, yeah.
Yeah.
One of my favorite climax scenes ever, you know. So Pooja, one of the viewer, she has an interesting question about the scene breakdown of the Johar scene. Okay. Can we have Pooja?
Abhe, record kar mera question, Pooja!
Vinay, can we have Pooja?
Please.
Okay, anyways, I've asked what she was trying to ask about the breakdown of that scene, about what was the VFX, the burning, the flames. It's too impactful.
Yeah, this is a very important scene for the film because you know, for me, this was the final. In the visual world of the film, this was we had the beautiful world of Padmavati and the very rustic, raw world of Alauddin Khilji. And this is for me the point where the beauty and the beast meets. I mean, this is the like how you kind of finally come to that that conclusion, that the end of that piece. So I was working as a visual designer. I was working towards this scene. In a way, and Sanjay had kept mentioning something that, you know, I want that whole river of red towards the end. This is like a, should be like a red river flowing into the fire. So so this was the most important scene in the film.
Right. But how did you manage the actors going so near to the fire? You know, what
was the fire was actually a couple of dinos kept on the floor. There was no real fire. You can't shoot with real fire. The fire was VFX.
In fact,
we had just simulated the lighting of the fire through lighting rigs, and the staircase motion was all shot in the night. So.
Right. In fact, there's a lot of last two or three questions. Then I'll hand it over to the panelists because there's a lot of questions and we're running out of time. Since a lot of people are asking questions about regional films, your Bengali film you did after Dhoom 3. Dhoom 3 was a 150 crore film, and the Bengali film you did was.
I don't know.
So, how come that shift, and how do you manage to shoot such a small film after doing such a big film?
You know, I always want to do all kinds of films. I mean, aisa nahi hai, it's very unfortunate that people think that I'm only doing big films, or I want to do big films. I want to do all kinds of films, and just that it has to fit in the time slot and everything else. So this was I had a little free time. I'd gone to Kolkata and I met Sujit, who's an old friend. And he told me that we'll do this film, and I was very excited by it. It was just like 20-25 days of shoot, and very small budget. I really wanted to see if I still have it in me to, because I've been only doing big films. To do a small film like that, and you know, where there are no equipment, and you know, they'll not, you won't have a Panther dolly, and you won't have big lights, and it was fantastic to, you know, to get there, and like very rewarding actually.
So, Devansh wants to ask something next about your recent work. Can we have Devansh, Vinay?
Yeah, Devansh, can you hear us?
Yeah. Sir, great work. I just wanted to ask you a question, that which is the recent film or cinematography that you have seen in the recent years in Hollywood and Bollywood, which made you feel jealous?
Jealous is...
Jealous is a strong word. I would say inspired. But jealousy is a very negative feeling. Being inspired is something nice. You know, we as cinematographers, as a community, we are a very strong community. We are a very close-knit community. And in our world, there's not much jealousy. When you see somebody else do some good work, you feel, "Achha, tune kiya, chal, main bhi karke dikhata hu. Abhi main dikhata hu, abhi mera wala dikha bhi." So I wouldn't say jealousy, but yeah, I wish I would have shot some films. I mean, I wish Thumbad had come my way. I absolutely love the way Thumbad looks. I mean, it was very, very, very special work.
Regional film?
I love Kumbalangi Nights.
Oh, wow.
I think it was beautiful. It was so understated and so natural and so, at the same time, so stylish and so engrossing.
So, do you, after watching 1917, I felt so small. Do you think we are we capable of making a shooting a film like 1917? I mean, just giving that example, because
absolutely
so terrific the way it was shot of, and that level of prep.
I think technically we are not any way behind any international thing. I think we have excellent technicians. We have very able people to do it. So yeah, I'm sure. You can do. If one wants to do, one can do.
Right. A lot of web series have been shot these days, and we see a lot of web series. Do you see any difference in approach, the way you shoot a web series over a film? You know, because web series is almost 450 to 500 minutes of content, and films is much lesser. So,
certain big stories can only be told in a web series. It's a very, very it's a wonderful format. There are some big stories. Like, to ek film mein 2 ghante mein kehna bahut mushkil hai. So you have to. That's the only way to do it. Personally, I've not done any. As a cinematographer, I feel it's one of my responsibilities to lure the audience into the cinema hall, because when you watch a trailer, today, everything you know is going to come on a streaming platform within a month or two. So there is always, when you're watching a trailer of a film, that's always that feeling ki ha chalo theek hai wo to Amazon pe aa jayega ya Netflix pe aa jayega dekh lunga. But to make an audience decide ki nahi yaar ye main theater mein ja ke dekhunga. I think we play a big role in that, you know, in luring the audience towards it. So web series mein wo incentive nahi hai. So that's a little shortcoming as far as I'm concerned.
Ron Bhattacharya has a question about aspect ratio. Vinay, can we have Ron Bhattacharya? It's related to photography and cinematography. So,
yeah. Ron, can you hear us? Ron?
Yeah, I can. Hi. Yeah. Can you hear me? Hi.
Hi.
Actually, I don't want to see myself.
That's okay. We can see
you.
We can see you. You have a fabulous mustache and a very exciting looking person.
Yeah, but all I am seeing is myself. So. Okay. Yeah. I can see you now.
And you have fantastic four-poster behind you.
Actually, since Sudibhai, so you just fantastic work and your personal works. Actually, I thought those white, light coming on from the top. There was some image of a dharmashala where there was this green ambient, and there was this ambient light coming from the top and lighting the outside of the laboratory. There's fantastic light there. Something you remember. So what happens, I'm asking especially because I think most of us here are from the still photography background. So what happens with us is, this is one thing I'm asking, because now a lot of, even in commercial photography and all, the clients and everybody are more inclined towards videos, because that's where the things are moving. So when we try to do video, we have this mental block because we are so obsessed with this perfect still image that the moment the camera starts moving, our sense of composition gets really challenged because we are not used to that. Whereas cinematographers are naturally inclined to that. So how did you negotiate that part? Or went to FTIA helped you that way? Because I have some friends who went to FTIA and did cinematography and stuff. They are pretty good and natural with that. Whereas, personally speaking, I'm always concerned, like, I will spoil this. The moment the camera moves, I will spoil this because there are so many shots. Because I will give you one example. I don't remember the film's name, but it was, DOP was Ajoy Kaur. It was a black and white film with Soumitra Chattopadhyay in it, I think. You can actually freeze each of those images. And there was this, Ashok Kumar and Nutan film also, where you can actually freeze each images and they are individually perfect shots. Actually, it's black and white, both of them. So how do you negotiate that? How do you go into that transition in a shortest?
I don't know.
And also aspect ratio, because when you are going to film, it's mostly a wider aspect ratio that you are dealing with.
Me and my brother used to do photography. And my brother had this very strange habit of, taking various stills. And he would always tell me that, this is my first frame and this is my last frame. And, imagine a camera movement over there. So this was something that he used to do, and I used to be very fascinated by that. So, I don't know. I've always been, always seen from a very early stage, frames as a part of a movement. So I always wanted to shoot moving images. So it never really, but having said that, moving images also require very, very solid composition. I don't think that conflicts.
Last question for me, then moving on to the panelists. A lot of photographers are aspiring DOPs here. So maybe you can put some light on the process of the transition. Is it necessary to be a second AC or a first AC? Because most of the first AC, I have realized that they end up the first AC for a very long time before they actually they get the first independent project. So any strong, insightful advice you would give it to them at the stage if they want to shift their profession at this stage?
I mean, being a first AC and being a director of photography in our country, I worked in technicians in Hollywood and in other countries, and there a first AC a lot of first ACs remain first ACs throughout their life. They don't aspire to be a DOP. You know, it's a very specialized job, it's not necessarily every first AC will become a good director of photography. It's a very specialized job. It's a job where
it's more logistical.
Yeah. So if you are aspiring to be a DOP from being an assistant, then I think you're working with somebody, and it's possible that you get too much of that person's style into you. So you have to be very aware of your own sensibilities, your own way. I always keep the conversation with my assistants that, keep your own thoughts alive. Keep that mental faculty.
And the impact of going to a film school or not being able to going to a film school, do you think that doesn't
matter? See, I think technically you can learn everything pretty much without going to a film school also. Today, more so. You can watch all the films. What film school, I think what it helped me and what a film school generally helps me is, I think, the 3 years that I spent in FTI with very like-minded people, cocooned in that world of cinema, gave me a lot of time to look into myself, to kind of explore myself and to form my identity. And I think that's very important, because what is special about the images that I'm going to make is that they're my images. They're about myself. So the more self-realized person you are, the more you've self-explored, I think your images will be more, more pertinent to yourself, hence more unique. So so going to a film school, that would help me a lot it's not just about the technique. I think that exploration is very important. And a film school gives that atmosphere to do that.
Right.
But so, today, you can see films everywhere. You can learn on the net, and it's very possible to technically.
So today I had the pleasure of seeing Baban sir silent for so long, it never really happens, So anything, sir, you want to add?
No, it's going fine. You're doing a great job. Hence, the only reason why I'm quiet is because it's going very well.
Yeah, otherwise, I wouldn't.
I would have, you know how I am.
The other panelists, co-partners of Vinay.
I wanted to ask, or maybe, this is my personal experience that being a photographer, and then, I've done a couple of films which are not commercial, but just for myself and, for my clients, which they were not commissioned to me. And I realized that, when a still photographer is looking for to make a film, he's not seeing, basically what he's seeing is all the 24 frames per second, each and every single frame. It's not like 24 frames per second ho gaya to wo us hisab se film banega. So when I sit on edit table and suddenly one shot will come in between 24 seconds or 1 second, then I'll say, okay, man, this is just not happening, because, then you're still looking like a photographer. Does that help you? Like, do you see things like that?
It's a trap. Sometimes you do fall in the trap. you do fall in the trap sometimes.
Yeah.
In fact, that day, I think a woman asked me that day that, I thought it was a very interesting question. When do you stop lighting?
Yeah.
When do you know that it's enough? It's,
yeah.
When you said you're being quiet, I was about to ask you that question again. but when do you stop lighting? Yeah.
Because, there's a time that on set that everyone's like looking at you and saying, "Ab kab ready bolega?" That's the moment that you have to let it go. And
Your
start smelling correct, I think.
I'm sorry, I'd like to share something over here.
Please.
It's a beautiful thing from what you said. I did a play many years ago, also called Six Degrees of Separation. And I'm an art aficionado in the play. And I do a monologue about something very similar. And I asked my teacher, I asked the teacher of my kids in class, why are the students in the fourth grade okay painters, and in the third grade so much better? So you're teaching in the third grade, so why are your students better? And the answer in the monologue is saying, I don't teach them anything. I just know when to take their paintings away from them.
Wow.
So beautiful. So beautiful.
It's the same thing.
I'll remember that woman. That's fab.
I'll send you the monologue. I've got this. I'll send you the monologue. It's beautiful.
Hi, Sudeep.
Hello.
Wonderful learning about your journey and your thoughts on visuals, and you know the way you put it, it's so simple and lovely and so clear. Now, the question I'd like to ask is, any giants, maybe directors or other DOPs who've been an influence to you?
Since you have worked with all the three Khans and all the big actors.
The actors.
Not
necessarily people you've worked with, am I right? Is that what you're asking, Amit?
Not necessarily.
Yeah, it could be from anywhere.
A lot of directors I would want to work with. It's a very long list.
I'm saying influences. Who left a mark in your memory, and you know, they somewhere a little bit of that thought process creeps in, you know?
Cinematographers, of course, Subrata Mitra to start with. I mean, that's also the world that I know. That's the world, that the place that I come from. So I find there's such his work is so endearing. The places that you see, that's so that's what that's actually another thing. That's
endearing. That's such a lovely word to use.
Such a lovely word.
I recently, when you asked me, I forgot to mention a movie that I recently saw, Gully Boy. I think Jay's work in that film is so fabulous. He makes that Dharavi slum so endearing. It's shot with so much love. And
someone told us that it looks like a small place of a big canvas.
Yeah, I felt like going and staying there in Murad's place. I mean, that's
The swag that you were talking about earlier.
Yeah, that's a quality that I tremendously look for, and Subrata Mitra's work as and Sven Nykvist and Conrad Hall and
you mentioned Vilmo Zsigmond the other day.
Vilmo Zsigmond, of course, and
Vittorio Storaro.
And Vittorio Storaro. Yes. And Rodrigo Pinto is my favorite, actually. I mean, I find his work so real and so so believable that
you would like to take Manas Takle to ask a question about the lighting breakdown, because a lot of people are asking about the lighting breakdown, about lighting.
Or can you question like that also?
If you can have Manas.
Manas, unfortunately, I think. Okay. Manas, can you hear us? Manas?
Okay, Manas is not there. Maybe if you can have
a question, Mikhail. I've been wanting to ask, is there Swapan here, Sudeep?
Please.
Sorry, Mikhail, Manas is there, but he doesn't have video. He just has audio. Manas, do you want to say your question?
I think he's not there right now.
Okay, so we can hop on to Swapan.
Okay. Yeah, hi, Sudeep. Swapan here. Thank you so much once again. For showing this to us, all of us who are so possessive about that one image, and maybe we do a photo story which has 24 images, but you work with, you know, those many in a second and you create magic out of it. But I had a question, and forgive me for my ignorance, because cinema is something I'm, you know, not as conversant with. I enjoy it. But they say when you see a film and you come back saying that, oh, the cinematography was great, somewhere perhaps the film has failed, because people get so caught up in the visual that the narrative of the film is sometimes camouflaged. So how important, and I'm sure you'd agree here, that the narrative, it has to be part of the narrative, that sometimes if a scene is too pretty, it comes in the way of the vision of the director. Your thoughts on this?
Absolutely. You know, you have to be, as a cinematographer, I would say your job is like a mother. You should be as selfless as a mother. You should care for the well-being of your child in the most selfless way. And only then you can raise a good child. I mean, that's an analogy that I would use to...
That's beautiful. Beautiful.
I have realized this, early in my career, and all of us go through this, that, in the insecurity that, your work should be seen. And I have done stuff where it has been very distracting. When I'm seeing the film and I have tried to get some eyeballs, and which completely takes away from the movie. And then you see that the film doesn't work. And then you realize that if the films don't work, no one gives a damn about your work. And whereas, when a film works, I think my work was appreciated in Chapde because the film in totality worked. If the film didn't work, then no one would have given a damn about my work. And I've seen that. Right. I've been a part of films where I thought well shot, but the film didn't work. And no one spoke about my work. So I came to the conclusion that the film has to work. Whatever it is, you have to work on the movie.
It's a means to an end kind of a thing. It's a means to an end.
So you will know that. The director's vision. You will know that when you're being indulgent, when you know that, if you're being honest to the project, and if you're being honest to the script, you'll know that. That ye galat hai. Ye light mein lagaunga to aankh udhar jayega. Abhi ek apna kya hai ki we have a, it's a big screen. It's a huge screen. And my job is to direct the vision. Ki main yahan dekho, kahan dekhunga. So that's a but guiding that vision, if you're being, even in a big long shot, I'll make you look at the actor.
Yeah.
In a big crowd.
So then would you say the Bansali films are allowing you more of this indulgence that you're talking about?
I didn't understand.
Would you say that the Sanjay Leela Bansali films are allowing you more of this indulgence that you're talking about? Personal indulgence?
No, not just indulgence. Also, Sanjay is very committed to the drama. So, it's not just the scale. There's also a story that we are trying to tell. And I find it pretty challenging actually to keep the story going in the middle of so much visual spectacle, because if one can lose the plot very easily in such grand frames. And I think Sanjay is doing a fabulous job in so much visual opulence. If you're still telling a story, then he's doing a very good job.
Sudipta, we're going to take Mitesh and Kanishka. They have been urging to ask since quite long. So can you have Kanishka?
So we have Mitesh on the line first. Mitesh, are you there? Mitesh, can you hear us?
We can hop on to Kanishka and then.
Yeah, Kanishka, can you hear us?
Yes, Kanishka.
Nikhil, can you read Kanishka's question? I'm trying to unmute him.
Kanishka, I didn't get her. Sir, I have a question for Sudipta about smoke and lighting.
Okay. Real pain in the ass smoke is. Yeah, everyone hates it. Actors hate it. Everyone hates it.
Yeah.
But it's...
Smoking is bad per se.
Yeah, but what's your question?
Maybe she hasn't. I'll add Aryan's question. He'll kill me if I don't ask because he asked 100 times. With over 100 days of shoot, how do you maintain your visual style and continuity? That's more of a continuity guy's job also, I know, but yeah.
No, I mean, the continuity guy, of course, writes the continuity after we have shot. This is something that you have to, you have to have the whole vision, a very big picture in your mind. And you have to remember the film that you saw when you read the script. And I think then the rest of it falls in place.
Good question. It can get tricky because you almost shoot for 200 days and there are various sequences and setups and characters. So, mendering is... it can happen.
Yeah, they do happen. They do happen, actually.
Okay, can I ask a question?
Can I come in now?
Yeah, please. Yeah. Anyone?
Can I?
Who's this? I mean, am I on or somebody else?
So, we'll get Amit Mehra and then we'll get Fauzan, if that's okay. Okay.
Amit Mehra can have...
Hi, Sudipta.
Hi.
Thank you so much for sharing such wonderful experiences. I would only say, you know, aap kaam nahi karte, aap kamal karte ho.
Very good. Please.
So, you know, there are so many films of yours have been my favorite, and I've been asking these questions to so many cinematographer friends. And especially, you know, you're talking so much about, and of course, your association with Mr. Bhansali has been very close. And you were talking about references, you know, when you people sit before the film and there are musical references, visual references, paintings and all those things. And it's very evident that Mr. Bhansali is he's very inspired by the Mughal aesthetics, you know, and especially by the Mughal architecture and the legends like K. Asif and Mughal-e-Azam.
Oh, yes.
The song sequence in Mardani, it was highly inspired by Mughal-e-Azam and K. Asif on those grounds. My question would be on the light, and especially for this Mardani song sequence, as well as the Ghumar, what you have shot in Padmavat. Now, there is a very magical light, and I'm still not able to, you know, crack that. How did you achieve that tonality? You know, it's a twilight in Ghumar. It's a twilight sequence going on, and it's a dusk sky, a gray sky, but again, the light is not tungsten. It's not even white light. It is something which is very metallic. I have never seen that. And I was in awe. There's a hue in the light. So how did you manage that metallic, you know, visual in the light?
See, Ghumar was shot indoors. So it's complete controlled lighting.
Yeah, one can make out. Yeah, the set is there. It's an indoor.
Yeah.
But what, was it the color temperature, or is it through the camera, or in post-production, or VFX? Because light is very unusual there.
We kept the color temperature slightly on the camera settings. I think we shot it at a little higher than 3200 Kelvin. I'm not sure. I think 3600 or something we must have shot it on. So that gave us a little warm. And also, the overall ambient lighting was soft boxes that we had rigged on the top. And they were dimmed down a little bit to give the extra warmth. And so once we had that that warmth, it was also affecting the skin tone a little. The skins were going too warm. So the skins on post-production, we kind of cleaned up and we got back the skin tones.
And plus a lot of fire was in the shot.
Yeah, a lot of fire was there.
Because you shot many frames with a wide angle. The whole song sequence has got more of the wide angle shots. So it becomes very evident as well as difficult, you know, how a cinematographer dealing with so many people moving around in the shots, and then hiding the lights also, and from where you are lighting up these.
Yeah, things. Then, you know, you have to be very much a part of the set design. I mean, you have to have the lighting plan very much in, like for instance, in the Diwani Mastani song in Bajirao Mastani, we knew what we were up against. We knew we had you know, massive problems with mirrors. So one of the things that I told my production designers is that, you know, when you're giving me mirrors, don't give me you know, big flat mirrors. Give me small broken mirrors. And I asked Mr. Bhansali that would he be okay with that. He said, yeah, okay, fine, that will look nice. So those broken mirrors actually helped me a lot in hiding the lights. I mean, you do see a lot of lights, but you don't realize their lights because you know, they're such small mirrors, and it doesn't really show. Also, one of my approach to lighting was that because we had in Diwani Mastani, we had very big wide shots, and it'd be impossible to hide lights. So my lights would often come from, you know, if you see the set, they have this kind of this semicircular dome kind of a thing.
Mm.
But the domes were made of mirrors, and I would keep my lights on the other side behind the camera, targeting on the dome, and they would come reflecting from the dome itself.
So we are running a little short of time. Three questions. We'll start with Kanishka.
Yeah, sure.
Kanishka, please go ahead.
Kanishka, are you there?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, Kanishka, hear you.
Sir, obviously, I've seen you work on Bajirao Mastani, and it was a pleasure. one thing I always wanted to ask, and how many times we've met, and I just couldn't ask because in discussing something or other, is the balance between the lighting and the smoke. When you are actually using Loban, or you use smoke machines to give a certain feel to the ambience, how do you know that this is just correct for me to shoot?
This is a very dicey thing. It's like I have very, very well-trained assistants who take care of this. And it comes with a lot of experience. We have to... this is something my assistant Oribon, he cracked, and then my Chang and all, they follow it right now, is smoking up the set in the beginning a lot, and then strategically placing smoke machines. It's very important how you smoke, place the smoke machines, and then you direct it with fans, and periodically you switch on the exhaust of the you do that too, one, and you switch on the exhausts, let the smoke go out. Keep the studio door open with some fans pointed outside, and you're continuously working on that. So that's a very tricky thing, and I credit goes to all my assistants who are continuously monitoring that. And
that's a really good question, because it gets really tricky to control that. You know?
Yeah. It's a big pain. And everyone hates you on set for that. And so many times you wait for the right smoke, and everyone's ready, and everyone's waiting, but the smoke is too much. So you have to say, okay, open exhaust number 4. and that will go, and you have to watch with your spot meter. I said, yeah, okay, now quickly let's do it. The smoke is right. So it's very tricky to shoot with smoke.
About the still dadas on the set. Okay, now in these days and age when people are just shooting with their mobiles, so what is the role of a still guy on the set? And considering the fact that you use so much you play so soft on the sets. How difficult is it for a still photographer to capture that essence on the sets?
I think it's very difficult for them, because the newer digital cameras are so sensitive. And I'm shooting with the Alexa LF, which is still on 800 ISO, but the sensitivity is super, super high. I mean, the lighting levels are really low. So it must be very difficult for them.
So you're taking a lot of job, yeah?
No, I think it's very interesting to, when I see, we can very easily grab a frame from the film scan and use that. But I think a good still photographer on set makes a lot of difference, because there's another way of looking at it. Somehow... it's always, I think it's very important to have a good still photographer on set, because a lot of times they come with their own vision, and they come with, and typically I usually get along a lot with them. So there's a lot of exchange to and fro, and sometimes they would show me a frame and I would incorporate it, and they'll never go out of job. I'm sure they'll.
Okay, what is his role on the sets? How do you define his role on the sets now? Earlier we used to be told that it's a part of the continuity, but now
that's not required.
How does the photographer fit into the scheme of things on the set?
I think publicity stills,
and that's usually from the producer side also this time.
But publicity stills, poster work.
Publicity stills done in the studio, no?
No.
A lot of directors don't prefer that. A lot of directors actually use publicity stills that are shot on the floor while the scene is being done.
Maybe Amit Dasher or Tarun can answer that also.
Yeah. Well, the only publicity still I shot was for this movie Pukar, which was way back in 98, I guess. So, I've not shot any, but I've shot publicity stills on studio separately. When the artist comes separately for the whole thing, I shot for... Zindagi Na Milegi Dobara, and Dhoom 2, and stuff like that. But I don't know, maybe somebody else can answer.
Mitasha, probably, yeah.
Continuity, I've never shot, actually.
So before, can we have Samar to ask the last question before we move towards closing? Samar?
Samar, yeah, hi. Thanks so much for sharing some really tremendous work of yours.
I just had one question, which was, you know, Bombay film industry is so enriched by of people who come from regional spaces, let's say from the east of Ireland. Would you say that a lot of your cinema is thinking is influenced by what you grew up in, Bengali cinema and drama and theater, or do you say, would you say that was not true with early Bollywood exposure for you?
Meera.
Personally, you know, I didn't have much Bollywood exposure. My parents used to look down on Hindi cinema a lot, and we were not allowed to watch Hindi films. And we would only get to see Hollywood movies or good Bengali films, some one or two rare good Hindi films. So because it was a forbidden product, I was always very excited.
Hindi films made by Bengalis.
Yeah. But it was a forbidden thing. So one was always very excited by it. I think when I'm lighting up, essentially I'm drawing a lot from, my memory. Because if I'm doing an evening scene, it's some evening I've seen. I don't know where I've seen that, in some movie, in real life, you always. So I think where you've grown up, how your childhood has been, how your world has been, that has a lot to do with what you bring into the table. I think I bring in a lot of that sensibility into my work, from my world, how I grew up, the kind of.
So one quick one before we finish, you experience and work with so many amazing directors and, you know, some brilliant films. Do you think there will be a time when you'll be looking at your own film? I'm sure a lot of people ask you that.
I'm very far from where I want to be as a director of photography. I mean, I'm still not. Probably, if there comes a time when I feel that, yeah, I've done enough, so I'm very far from that point. And I have a lot of hunger, and I'm really started to enjoy my work, and I want to go very far. So sometimes the desire to make a film comes out of a frustration that, as a director of photography, you don't have a complete control over the film. And as a thinking artist, you have a different opinion, and but then you can't do anything about it because you're not directing the film, and you have to let go. So that sometimes gives you the thinking, yeah, shit, let me make my own film. But I think that's not a good reason to, you should make your own films when you have to make your own film.
Right.
And
that is true.
Thank you. Gusse se aata hai kabhi ki yaar main banata hu. A lot of people end up making films from that approach, and they do a very bad job, because wo ek film banane ka keeda jab aayega andar se tabhi banana chahiye.
So Sudipta, before we actually close and hand it over to Devang, of course, great insights about your journey, and I'm sure that you wouldn't be as chilled out as you look right now on the sets. I believe you would be a different person. I don't know.
On the set?
Yeah.
No, I'm very chilled out. Okay. I can't operate in chaos, and it's very important for me to have a very peaceful environment. But when you're shooting, when you're creating something, you are slightly sensitive. So you're you're a little touchy. That I think is
so true. Before we actually close, and of course, me and Baman sir have little angst against your Houseful 4 because it's released with Made in China. But that's off the topic. Baman sir, you want to add anything before we close and give it to Devang?
Absolutely beautiful. And I think we are pretty privileged to have shared this with you today. So really privileged. All of us, I'm saying this on
your own. Privilege for me just to share.
You keep saying stalwarts, but then...
These are people I really look up to. I mean,
just see how they're listening, hanging on to every word that you're saying, my friend. Thank you so much.
Very honored. I see a lot of questions on the chat thing. I'm sorry we don't have the time to answer that, but what I think is if there's a way that I'll try and do a session on Instagram Live, probably where you can put these questions. And try putting those questions over there. I'll put out a thing, And I'll try and answer everyone's questions.
Dinda, we'll also be sending you a chat file of the saved questions. We'll try and send it to you over email.
Okay, sure.
Great talking to you. It's my personal wish also to work with you someday if I get
please
a chance.
Remember, Bolani next time.
I wanted to say one more thing. Mikhil, you asked fabulous questions.
Very good questions.
Every photographer would like to ask. So, you know, the way you took us through the whole journey of his, he was answering
absolutely.
So good. Your questions were so to the point. They were like fantastic. So, thank you so much for that.
Thank you. Well done.
Absolutely.
In fact, you know.
Great. Thank you so much, guys.
Thank you.
Devang, if you could take over.
Yeah, thank you so much, Sudeep Da. That was, of course, the work has nothing to be said more about. Mikhail has definitely, you know, covered all the questions very well. You have shown some brilliant work. We've seen it so many times on the movies also. Thank you so much for showing your work. Thank you. And I think you know, when we were starting the session, you were saying, yaar, main question mujhe puchhenge log. You were showing us that you were quite apprehensive, but I think you've answered all the questions very modestly.
No, that's thanks to the way the questions were asked. I mean, that's very important that, you know.
Yeah, I'm just coming to Mikhil to thank him for, you know, moderating this session. It has been a real pleasure. Both of you have really kept the entire audience enchanted with the conversation that was going on. So it was not like a question answer. It was more like a conversation. And thank you, Mikhil, for that as well.